Now, so there have been unrests in Pak-occupied Kashmir, Gilgit-Baltistan, Sindh, and Balochistan. In fact, I just saw a video from Balochistan where the very, very tough questions are being asked of the ruling junta. Now, however, all these things, right, they arise for 2, 3 days. It's not able to sustain itself, which means at the ground level, the people are not angry enough. Furthermore, you see how ethnic cleansing is taking place in rural Sindh and rural Punjab, where the minorities, and I include Christians, Buddhists, Sikhs, and Hindus, all of them are being forcibly converted to Islam. They have like a timetable, and they are keeping track of which girl turns, has puberty, and then immediately that girl is, stolen away, taken away, sometimes forcibly raped by the entire village, and then married off to a special needs person. Very gory stories are coming. I mean, they are talking about 3 girls per day, and the entire country and the entire world, just like they ignore Uyghurs, they are ignoring this. Why isn't Indian government at least educating Indian Kashmiris, saying this is what they do there? Why is this not happening?
This is a very, I would say, tricky area to go into because now we have started educating. I mean, India, Indian government also, like, and even in the Indian intellectual think tank circles. But for a very, very long time, I must say that Indian academia, the think tank world, and media was dominated by a class of intellectuals, who were blind to these things. They had very hidden political motives, and they would simply not talk about these things. For instance, I would say that some of the very prestigious Indian universities and colleges, if you would go to them, like back in 2012, 2013, they would not want to talk about Balochistan. They would just simply support the Naxal causes. They would support the separatists in Kashmir. Even the interlocutors, some of the esteemed interlocutors sent by the government of India and Kashmir, you would be surprised. They mentioned nothing about the Jamaat-e-Islami's radicalization role in Kashmir and their extremist activities. Some of the interlocutors were even dining with Ghulam Mohammad Fai in America, before joining the government of India as interlocutors. So we had a very, I would say, a system as in our government and our academia, our media, all these institutions were heavily dominated by a certain class of intellectuals, officers, who had they have a certain bias, or a certain, I would say, proclivity towards Islamist activities. Maybe they are financed, or it is some kind of a personal love or whatever. But they completely prevented these things. But then now I think we can see many attempts and efforts to get into these things, and certainly I would say that Indian state is also to be blamed for many things. They never had any consistent policy as far as these strategic and intelligence related issues are concerned in Pakistan. Like, some of our former prime ministers completely seized all the raw operations in Pakistan. One of our former prime minister, gave away all the secrets to the foreign nation head in Pakistan. And then one of our former prime minister came to the power, and on the advice of a certain professor from JNU, stopped all the secret of covert operations in Pakistan. Destroyed, dismantled all our assets, that know that this is the land of Gandhi and Buddha, and we cannot get into this zone. So this kind of inconsistency, or this kind of immaturity, lack of professionalism, which has absolutely gripped our security apparatus, prevented us from doing something, I would say, concrete, or something, with something robust with longer term ambition in this direction. And in Kashmir, I must say that on the propaganda and the narrative warfare, the anti-India elements are much stronger, and the radicalization levels are so high that even the people, those who are educated, and those who are, I would say, people with rational minds, they would want to, I mean, they would prefer to be blind to these things, and they would want to support, I would say, Pakistan or Turkey's agenda. That is also one fact. But then there is a class which is emerging, and who are trying to understand these things, and who, like, you know, now openly speak against Pakistan, and they are mostly youngsters. You can see many examples, like, you know, the young leaders like Sajid Yusuf, okay, or Mir Junaid, Mudassir Tantre. And these people, now they are understanding that, you know, I mean, India is a country where they have a future, and Pakistan is a country where even the Muslims are persecuted in the worst manner. Okay? And they are coming out against it, but it will take some time. You know? Unless our universities and our education system is not reformed, you know, and we don't develop a very strong sense of strategic culture, then we cannot do much about it. Now, I'll just one more example. It's very interesting. You know, you will love it. Okay. So one of the, I would say, you know, a very prestigious private university in India, which has students from the elitist segments of society, or I mean, even the upper middle class from Delhi University, and students from, you know, Calcutta University, all people coming from good backgrounds. I was just, you know, listening to one of its lectures, you know, and through some online forum, okay, and I found that there's this Muslim professor who comes from Lucknow. And she is a PhD. She is openly defending Tablighi Jamaat. One student gets up and says that, well, I have Stratford reports claiming that Tablighi Jamaat is contributing, the recruits to terrorist organizations. And these are well documented reports. The French police reports, and they say that 80% of radicals in France, they come from Tablighi Jamaat background. Then that professor said that, well, you just shut up and get out of my class, you know, because this is completely false, you know. Then she is teaching things that, you know, all the temple destruction thing in India happened mostly during the pre-Muslim period by the Hindu rulers like Rashtrakutas, Chalukyas and Cholas and all, you know. And what you are taught by the certain right-wing organizations, this is complete false. Now, what I feel is that, I mean, I look at it as from a critical lens as a security analyst, you know. I mean, now if these are the false ideas which you are teaching your, you know, young generation, these people are going to work in future in the think tanks and in the government, in the foreign services, even in the defense. And, you know, if they grow up with an idea that Tablighi Jamaat is a very fair, rational and an honest charity organization, then, I mean, you don't expect them to, you know, question what's happening in Balochistan. So I think we need to completely overhaul, you know, our education system and, you know, cultivate that rational faculty where people, you know, are able to, you know, learn more about the strategic culture which India needs. That is something which is really required.
So two last things before we wind up today's show. In fact, it's taken longer than I expected, but it's a very interesting conversation. One thing is this guy, Shah Faisal, was supposed to, quote-unquote, have topped the IAS exam, which now we are finding out that there was a heavy amount of handicapping given to make that happen. He said he was going to resign, blah, blah, blah. Looks like he is back now. What's the status on that?
So Mr. Shah Faisal, actually, the problem with him is that the day he cleared IAS exam, you know, I mean, and there are many stories, you know, how he cleared the exam, okay, you know, and, you know, there were people sitting at the top, in the top echelons of power in India who thought that, you know, I mean, making a Kashmiri, you know, clear an IAS exam would offset all these, you know, revolutionary or this youth unrest and all. Okay, you know? So I don't know, I mean, what motivated them to think like that. But, you know, well, we may not have a clear evidence to prove that, you know, all this thing was maneuvered. But then, yes, you know, certainly, you know, this needs more investigation. You know? But then Mr. Shah Faisal was invited by Prime Minister Manmohan Singh, you know, right after he was selected. So since that day, it got into his mind that, you know, he is someone who is destined to be of that level, you know. He is not just an IAS officer. So right the moment he joined services, you know, after that, he had political ambitions and he thought that he would become another Sheikh Abdullah of Kashmir. Okay? And, you know, he would, I mean, even like, you know, with his batchmates and all, his behavior was entirely different. He wouldn't talk to them as if they are their batchmates, you know. Many of the people, they say that, I mean, it was a very arrogant, you know, behavior that they came across. As an administrator, his performance has been very poor. Okay, you know, I have not come across anyone appreciating his work as an administrator. You know, he was always there for symbolic gestures and with political ambitions. And then, right after a few years, he went to Harvard to study. Normally, it doesn't happen in India. If you want to go to study in a foreign university, then it takes many years for a general IAS officer to get that kind of clearance. The factors and what supporters, like what kind of, you know, people supported his, you know, I would say desires to study in Harvard at such an early stage, that is still again a puzzle, you know, okay. And in Harvard, he was, you know, getting in touch with all kinds of people, you know, from all kinds of countries, which is an open secret, you know, okay, maybe Pakistan, Turkey, you know, and well, I don't want to get into all those nitty-gritties, you know, but, you know, he wanted to revive an organization which had gone defunct in 1987-88 only. And he came back to India thinking that, you know, he would receive a hero's welcome. And here he tried to join it. But then, I mean, you know, this abrogation of Article 370 completely, you know, failed all his schemes. You know, initially he thought that he would join National Conference, but then there he realized that Dr. Farooq Abdullah and Omar Abdullah would never let him become the another Sheikh Mohammed Abdullah of Kashmir. Okay, so he came up with his own party. And very soon people also realized that he is an, I mean, you know, very opportunistic, you know, class of person, opportunistic person, you know, because on one hand he was, you know, getting all the benefits of IAS, and at the same time he was criticizing Indian government, you know, from which, I mean, he had worked for the government, and he was making all kinds of allegations against the Indian government just for the political benefits. So now his credibility among the people is completely destroyed. Like, you know, people don't want to see him, because Kashmiris have seen, like, you know, such opportunistic politicians for decades in the past. And, you know, if another face, like, you know, another face of opportunism comes up, you know, that is something which Kashmiris would hate the most, you know. And here it is interesting, for someone like Amit Shah and Narendra Modi, there is still a respect, because Kashmiris feel that they do what they say. But for the Kashmiri mainstream politicians, they have no respect. They have no respect for Mehbooba Mufti, because they said that, you know, Mehbooba Mufti is now giving the maximum number of abuses to BJP, and she is the one who formed the government with BJP. On one hand, she is dabbling with Pakistanis, and on the other hand, she is, you know, forming the government with BJP. So they have no respect for the state level politicians. So Mr. Shah Faisal, now he's trying to get back into IAS, you know, and I don't know, I mean, I keep hearing things that he's coming back, he's joining as some advisor or whatever, okay. Maybe he will have some benefactors in IAS, you know, I mean, the IAS lobby, you know, which, you know, that it works in the interest of the IAS group only. Maybe they want to bring him back to set an example that, you know, even a person with anti-national inclinations can be roped in, can be brought back into services, so that the more openings come up in the future for such people. But I'm sure, you know, this government, you know, PM Modi's government will not take him back. And by any chance, if that person comes, you know, government will be questioned, you know, Modi government will lose all credibility in front of the common people, okay, because he is an outright anti-national.
So last question for today's hangout, Abhinav, how do these people explain their names? Shah, Mattu,
yeah,
Bhatt, these are all Kashmir Pandit names. These are all people. A Mattu is somebody who was working in Mutts, which are Shankaracharya Mutt and Sharda Peet Mutt. All these people who used to work in the Mutt, were called Mattus. And Bhatt were actually Pandits. You know, they are Pujaris. Do you call them Bhattarai in Nepal, Bhattar in Tamil Nadu, Bhatt in Karnataka? So these are all, you know, occupations are very, very sanctity, you know, very, very precious and sacred. And now they are saying that they are Muslims. They are hardly 300-year-old Muslims. For thousands of years, they were Sanatanis. Doesn't one among these millions stand up to think, why is my last name this?
Very good question. Well, first of all, I mean, that whatever faith they are practicing, I mean, I have no problems with that. You know, I would certainly respect whatever faith they are practicing right now. But the problem arises when they refuse to recognize, or when they refuse to accept their, you know, past, their identity. Okay? And that's the problem, like, you know, which has always been with Kashmir. Okay, so in Kashmir, especially, it was a place of intellectuals, you know. And let me tell you, you know, the people, Kashmiri people, they are not martial race, okay, you know. And even now, the local militants who are joining the militant, local Kashmiris who are joining the militant organizations, they are untrained. You know, you look at them and you will understand that these people, I mean, he is meant for writing a good poetry, or, you know, doing some kind of a spiritual practice, or some kind of an intellectual work. And because of this fact that they are not a martial race, they were always ruled by foreigners. Okay, in 14th century, Dalucha Khan and these people came, raided Kashmir. And then I think Sikandar Khan, during Sikandar Khan's reign, they were converted. You know, these conversions began. Then Mughals ruled over Kashmir, and Mughals, you know, they made...
Aurangzeb wreaked havoc, yeah.
Yes, they took a lot of girls to their harem, Kashmiri girls to their harem, and they, you know, created a culture in which promiscuity was, you know, I would say, you know, motivated, incentivized, you know. Like, just, this, suppose this name I come up, you know, Shopian. Shopian comes from the word called Shapain. When the Mughal rulers, you know, Jahangir and his entourage, visited Kashmir in the summers, you know, the first place where their camp, you know, rested was Shopian, and it was named because it was the Shah, the king, you know, Shah's spine, the Shah's foot fell on that place for the first time. Okay, that's why it was called Shopian, you know, which comes from Shapain. There they took all the girls in their harem, you know, married them for a day or two, okay, and I mean, who got into physical intimacy and relationship with all the Mughal courtiers, and in return they were given a lot of land, property, and you know, everything. Okay, so that became a custom in Kashmir. Okay, and then they, you know, just to, you know, that kind, you know, see, if that actually, if they think about it, that would have brought a lot of guilt and embarrassment. But then, just to avoid that guilt, you know, they started, you know, delving deeper, or instead, you know, glorifying and celebrating these borrowed identities. Then Pathans ruled over Kashmir, then Sikhs ruled over Kashmir. Even when in 90s, you know, when General Ziaulhaq wanted to, you know, I would say, this prop of militancy in Kashmir, he openly said that Kashmiri Brahman ki aulaad hai, wo kya jang ladega. These are the recorded statements, you know. So that somewhere got, I mean, it gets into Kashmiri minds that, you know, that unlike the, you know, Muslim communities in Pakistan, Balochistan, or in the Middle East, we are not the martial race, you know. So just to overcome that, you know, they are coming more and more under the grip of these radical and fanatical things. But then, you know, I mean, I must say that this is not something which is in the DNA of Kashmir. If you go to Kashmir, if you talk to a lay Kashmiri man and a woman, they are very liberal, okay, and they are very soft-hearted, mild-mannered people. Okay? But they have been completely misled, you know, and still the very fact that, you know, they are retaining their surnames, you know, these Mattus and Bhats and all, shows that, you know, somehow that they are very attached to that, you know, that place and their original identity, the roots, okay, you know. But then the forces who try to, you know, like, you know, bring, create a dominant narrative of a very radical Islamist doctrine in Kashmir, okay, they are becoming very powerful, and I think we also need to, you know, somewhere, you know, put up a resistance and show that, that, well, your identity was this, okay. It's a big factory of lies which is actually working. Okay, I mean, they know that, you know, they were Saraswat Brahmins. In fact, even Mr. Gilani said it once, you know, that they were, you know, that they come from the lineage of Saraswat Brahmins. Okay, but then, you know, I mean, if they accept it, admit it, there would be a big embarrassment and a big loss of pride. You know, they are already looked down by Pakistani intelligence establishment and the jihadist, even Taliban for that matter. You know, when the Taliban militants or Afghani militants came to Kashmir, they would say that, well, this is not a place for jihad. We thought that India is not letting them perform namaz and all, but India is letting them perform everything. But here are the people who want to wear best of the clothes, you know, buy the most modern gadgets, you know, branded, they want to wear branded shoes, branded jeans, okay, they want to have girlfriends, they want to, I mean, no. So this is not a place of jihad. They would go back that, you know, we don't want to stay here. Even for now, I mean, if you look at the Kashmir militancy, in Kashmir, you know, 60-70% people are on drugs.
That's another problem.
Even females are taking drugs, you know, and because of drugs, the females, you know, those who, the burqa clad females who would come for stone pelting, okay, they would get money for doing that, and because of drugs they become addicted to these things, and then they get into prostitution. So this is the reality. All these Pakistani sponsored terrorist organizations, they are selling drugs to get money. So I mean, underneath jihad, it's all false lies and deceit.
He said the drug smuggling now reduced because of, you know, increased security and things like that?
No, I think it has increased, you know, because, you know, they are coming, drugs is coming from Punjab border, okay, and they are coming from Jammu border. They also, on the LOC, situation has become a little tighter because of the electronic surveillance, you know, systems which we have put up. But then they are coming from the other borders, like Jammu and Punjab border mostly, okay, you know. And then it's easier to carry a packet of drugs. You know? I mean, the reason why terrorist organizations would always prefer the drug channels is that, you know, it's always easier to generate finances through that. If you carry a bag full of cash, you know, and try to cross the border, there are chances of being caught. They are heavier, and, you know, I mean, you might be killed in an operation. But, you know, it's very easy to carry a small packet of, you know, cocaine or heroin, a small 1 kg packet, which would be sold at like 5 crores, maybe 3 crores in the open market, in the international market, you know. So they would always prefer drugs. And then a population, the young population, which is continuously fed drugs, it becomes addictive and it becomes very mentally very vulnerable and weak to foreign ideologies which can radicalize them. Be it, I would say, extreme communism or be it the ideology of political Islam. Such people, those who are on drugs, they become mentally very weak. It becomes very easy to bring them into the trap of weapons and, you know, I would say, the ideological radicalization and all. So that's why they would continue to keep the drug channel active.
How is the youth of Pakistan? They must be also facing the same problem there, right? Drugs?
Pakistan, Punjab, well, Punjab, yes, certainly they are facing, but then Pakistan society, it's like, you know, they're going through a heavy phase of radicalization in Pakistan. All the young journalists, you know, who are not anti-religion, but even they just try to, you know, talk sense, they are abducted by the army or, you know, they are killed by the, you know, the radical organizations. So in Pakistan, if you ask me like to describe the sentiment in Pakistan in broad terms, I must say like it's turning into a very barbaric and extremist societies, you know, where there is no place for, you know, I would say, you know, normal, sane, rational, secular minds. Okay, every day you have Shia killings in Pakistan. Nobody talks about it. Even the so-called Pakistani intellectuals and liberals, you know, they just express or, you know, come out with false statements and completely fabricated lies on Kashmir and what's happening in India. But they are completely blind to what's happening in their country. I mean, if you see Salman Taseer, the governor of Punjab, who was killed by Mumtaz Qadri, because Salman Taseer is no, I would say, great, some kind of, you know, a secular, rational man. But then on some occasions, he tried to defend Asia Bibi and he was shot by Mumtaz Qadri, his gunman. And if you look at the funeral of Mumtaz Qadri, the videos, you know, lakhs and lakhs of people attended the funeral. He was being celebrated as a Ghazi, as a martyr. So that, you know, brings out the sentiment of the Pakistani society.
Well, I suppose the Modi government still has its work cut out in Kashmir, and we are very, very, very far from normalcy. But as everything, I'm hoping that, let's say that Pakistan breaks up into four, or China stops funding. It's already there. China has also stopped funding. Kingdom of Saudi Arabia stopped funding. US was going to give $20 million and a lot of hue and cry has happened, and even that is being reviewed. So zero from US, zero from Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, and pretty much zero from China also, because China is reviewing its CPEC problem, CPEC corridor. And the only things they have, from what I've been hearing from guests, is that the port of Gwadar, around that area, Chinese have some control. And they have some control up till Gilgit. The entire plains, which is where the populace lives, no work done. And it's going to be a huge challenge for them. So I don't know how that's going to play out. Plus now China has also retreated from India's borders because it's seeing problems on the South China Sea. And we'll see how it goes. But it was a fascinating conversation, Abhinav. And it's my hope that we'll be back with more such conversations, because I believe we have just started a very long and fruitful partnership of, you know, exchange of ideas and, you know, thoughts and so on and so forth. And viewers, do feel free to send in your comments, and we will try and see if Abhinav can answer some of those questions. We'll see how it goes. But thank you very much, Abhinav. What started out as probably a 20-minute conversation has taken a lot longer, but we all learned a lot from you. Thank you very much, and namaskar.
Thank you very much, Namaskar.